Thank you.
It's like a cabaret act, isn't it?
I'm Glenys Parry. I'm a clinical psychologist and a psychotherapist. I'm also a professor emeritus at Sheffield University. But the reason I'm talking to you is that I am part of gay history. I know this because they've just published a book about the early years of the campaign for homosexual equality, which I was interested to find out in it. So I'm officially part of gay history, if you want to pass that around. The reason is that in 1970-ish, when I went to university, University of Manchester, I was looking forward to meeting other gay people and coming out. I think that's quite a common experience. I resonated with Heather's account there. And one of the things I did, apart from finding a gay club, meeting some women, I found what was then called the Committee for Homosexual Equality, and contacted them and joined. And soon we were moving on and becoming very much a national campaign. And CHE was very active in the 70s and 80s. It still exists, would you believe, alongside GLF, the Gay Liberation Front. But GLF was very much a London-based outfit, very metropolitan, quite out and proud and loud, whereas CHE was a much more northern-based or national organisation. I mean, it had a lot of London groups, but it was a bigger organisation, and it was very much consisted of groups across the country of people who were not metropolitan sophisticates. They were very often very, very deeply in the closet or feeling very uncertain and about meeting other gay people. And it's, I think one of the things I want to discuss briefly, because I know we're running late, is the whole issue of how gay mental health links to social attitudes and what changes we've seen and what changes we haven't seen over those years. So when I was in this sort of 18-year-old, out and proud sort of place, starting a gay society at the University of Manchester, joining this campaign for homosexual equality, one of the things I did as a psychology undergraduate was to start to campaign against the labelling of homosexuality as a mental illness, as a disorder. Which it was. It was officially a diagnosis. And worse even than that, although I guess it was, it's seen by some of the people who, some of the psychiatrists and some of the people who thought of it as a disorder, they felt that that was a sort of progress from seeing being gay as some sort of moral, perverted choice of transgressive bad behaviour. It was almost seen like, oh well, as Lord Arran, who was one of the lords who pushed for homosexual law reform actually, but he came up as to debate with us at the university. And it was a formal debate, and his proposal was, a homosexual is a man, well hey, that's a problem to start with, who should be pitied and not condemned. So, you know, it was seen, oh well, you can't help it, poor dear, you're ill, you know. It's not your fault really, you're just ill. It's not some sort of moral inadequacy. So we defeated Lord Arran, actually, which we thought we were ungrateful, but it was something about wanting to stop the hugely oppressive practices that were going on. For example, aversion therapy was the usual treatment for homosexuality, so that psychologists would, in the behaviourist tradition, use aversive stimuli at the same time as you were having a sexual fantasy, a gay sexual fantasy. So the aversive stimulus could either be electric shock or a drug that made you very, very nauseous. Or even, as a psychologist called Beach did in Manchester, using a drug derivative of curare that temporarily paralyzes your breathing so you can't breathe, just for a moment, and it administers the antidote. That is, to me, one of the things that we really did push against, and through the British Psychological Society and through demonstrations, began through just talking to people, saying, oh, this is wrong. And we weren't alone, but it was quite a major, one of the major things that we did, one of them. The other thing that was taking off then was my own career in CHE. Obviously, I became chair of the organisation, and we did a lot of campaigning, a lot of TV appearances. My first public speaking engagement was to 3,000 gay people in Trafalgar Square, which is the first gay march. It was quite exciting, and we had lots of fun doing all that. I was one of the founders of Gay News, but I was also trying to get into a career as a clinical psychologist. So it was in parallel, really, and it was very interesting what being an out professional mental health worker was like. So, for example, I was telling Andy this in the video, when I was being interviewed by one university to become a clinical psychologist after I got my degree, there was this awkward silence at the end of the interview because I'd put down on the application form that I was involved with CHE, and they said, oh, well, just one little thing, you know, would you treat a homosexual? So it was still then, that was what, 1974. That was seen, well, how can you, you know, be openly gay and a psychologist? Because what would you do? Would you be able to treat somebody, meaning, you know, stop them being gay? So that's how it was. We started a gay therapist group, and that was a new thing. We had quite a lot of usual things. I mean, Heather's talk really did take me back. It was just like we did lots of similar things, but in the 70s. So, how far have we come? Well, I want to say something about gay mental health and well-being, because the whole LGBT plus mental health issue is still very, very problematic. I've got a reading list, actually, if anybody's interested afterwards. You're very welcome to have it. Now, there's problems knowing, of course, whether the sampling is representative, but there's been meta-analyses and surveys to suggest that LGBT mental health, on the whole, isn't as the people report more mental health difficulties in the LGBT plus communities and seek help more. Now, I think there are some problems, because in one of the surveys which combined the results of UK epidemiology, you know, where you interview people, they found that the proportion of LGBT people was something like 1.5% in their sample. Well, that's very small. Even a conservative estimate from other surveys suggests that around at least between 5 and 6% of the population of the UK report themselves as not being heterosexual, put it that way. So that worries me a bit about that finding, because who knows where the other 4% have gone, you know, are they just not participating? Because if someone stops you in the street and wants to ask you questions, it's easy to say, oh no, I'm not interested, I don't want to talk. And a lot of people do that. However, there is some evidence that mental health problems are problematic for people, and that not only that, the mental health provision in this country is very, very mixed, and there's been other work to show that although nobody now, the NHS doesn't provide aversion therapy or reparative therapies or conversion therapies anymore, homosexuality is no longer a mental disorder, trans people now have got some opportunities for gender reassignment and transition, which really was incredibly difficult in the 70s. I mean, there's still a long way to go, but it strikes me that there's very few gay affirmative, LGBT affirmative therapeutic services available, actually. And quite a recent survey of psychiatrists and psychologists and counsellors found that quite a large minority were willing, and did in fact, help people who come saying, I don't like being gay, I want to change. So that, you know, there's that kind of ethical dilemma. If someone's saying, I hate being gay, can you help me change? What does the psychologist or the psychiatrist do? And I suppose what I'm saying is that these heteronormative attitudes are internalised in quite a lot of LGBT people who come for help. A lot of the people I see who happen to be gay with mental health problems, the fact they're gay isn't necessarily anything to do with a mental health problem, but it may be if self-hatred and self-attack and self-internalized homophobia is part of mental health difficulty, because it isn't mentally healthy to hate yourself to that degree. So people with sensitive temperaments, perhaps people who've not had a secure attachment in childhood, or people who've really been unconfident or sensitive to others, are in some context, some family contexts, likely to become anxious, insecure, and unconfident in their sexual identity. So those homophobic attitudes that are still quite pervasive, actually, in many families, can be internalised. Whereas some of us, many people here, I'm sure, certainly myself, I never felt ashamed of being gay. I never felt it was a problem. And you didn't, Charles, either. You didn't. There's something about, well, you know, why not? Well, I suppose the luck of the draw. I was fortunate. I had a very confident, narcissistically buoyant temperament. I had a secure set of attachments. I knew my family loved me. You know, that wasn't ever an issue. And although coming out is always difficult to one's parents, eventually, you know, they if you're in that kind of, I know you love me and this will be fine, it is. But it's very hard to have that confidence if you haven't had the advantages of either a kind of sort of confident temperament plus a secure, loving family. I just want to finish really by saying how complex human sexuality is, because being gay, lesbian, bisexual, and trans, they're not things that are simple labels, although we use LGBTQI+ or whatever now. It's much more complex than that. For example, being sexually attracted or sexually aroused or having sexual behaviour with someone of your own sex doesn't mean that you are comfortable being loving or intimate with someone of your own sex. lots of people could say, oh, well, you know, I go cottaging, say, and I have a lot of sex with guys, or I'm on Grindr or whatever they do now. But I don't actually feel comfortable, you know. I would never say I'd love some of my own sex, and that's a kind of disjunction between sexual drive and or sexual arousal and intimacy or closeness or love, and they're not necessarily the same thing. Equally, just because you are attracted to someone of your own sex or you have fallen in love with someone of your own sex doesn't mean you have a gay identity. So it's quite common, I think, for people to recoil from the idea of saying, I'm a gay person, or I'm a lesbian. That wouldn't be a label that a lot of people would put on themselves. So I do think that gay identity is actually different from being attracted or being sexually intimate with your own sex. And gay clients protest quite often that their therapist just focuses on their same-sex relationship as the problem, or their gayness as the problem, rather than the other mental health issues. And I do think that one of the ways in which we must, within the NHS, within psychotherapy services, within mental health services, start to take seriously the need to provide LGBT affirmative care that is actually monitored and quality controlled, if you like. Because we try and do that to help, you know, people become culturally competent, you know. So there's this whole thing about, you know, are you culturally competent to do therapy with someone of a different ethnic or social background? But nobody's asking, are you culturally competent to do therapy with a gay person who's got a mental health problem? And I'd like to see that introduced into trainings. I'd like more psychologists and psychiatrists to come out. I just gave a talk to a group of, I think it was something like 100 or more, perhaps 250, clinical psychology trainees at UCL in London. And as part of it, I said, and how many people here are gay? And there was this kind of smattering of little hands coming up. And it was clear that a lot of the people in that, LGBT people in that room, just wouldn't feel comfy standing up and being counted. Until we do, I think it's hard to change things. Thanks very much.